welcome to Tuesday morning on this cooler day. My husband stepped outside and said, "I smell snow." I don't know if that was by faith or wishful thinking or I don't know. I don't know if we're that cool, but anyway, let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning for the opportunity to be here today, to just worship you, to be in your house with all these lovely ladies. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your word that we can break it apart and grow and learn by it. Thank you for your power that helps us. And Father, I just present myself to you this morning and I ask for your anointing, Lord. Let it be your words. And Father, if anything I get a little mixed up, I just pray by the power of the Spirit you would straighten it out, Father, so that truth would go forward in Jesus' name. Father, I lift up those that are a part of this church who are struggling with illness today. We pray for healing. We pray for the great physician to just come by and touch your servants today and bring healing in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you for your presence. We worship you today, Lord. Amen. We have doing something a little bit different this session. We have a winter book. We've always done a summer read, and now we're doing a winter read. Evidence Not Seen by Darlene Rose. And she is in the book, she writes about a newlywed missionary headed to New Guinea. She and her husband served some time there. And while they were there, they were taken prisoners by the Japanese during World War II. Separated from her husband, they're each in separate prison camps. And she writes about her journey and the faithfulness of God, the faithfulness of God's word sustaining her. And then she survives with this powerful spirit and desire still to serve the Lord and goes back to be a missionary. How incredible is that? So it's a great book, donation $13. We have the books available today. They are out at the Welcome Center. Sister Julie is going to have that available for you. So we'll take credit card, check, cash. Go out there and see her after the Bible study, and you're going to love this book. I'm telling you, it's hard to put down. We'll have a book review in January, toward the end, January 21st, I think. So you got plenty of time on those cold and cozy nights to curl up with this book and read and just be taken to places that we probably don't ever want to go. But how the Word of God sustained her. It's a powerful book. I've read it so many times. It's a great book. Don't you love a book like that, that you just read and read, and every time you read it, it's something new? Okay, so that's the winter book, Evidence Not Seen. Well, we are continuing our study of 2 Timothy. As you know, this is a strong but very heartfelt letter that the Apostle Paul wrote to his protege Timothy, who was serving as pastor of the church in Ephesus. Paul had started this church, probably with Timothy at his side. So Timothy was aware of the challenges that the Christians had faced at Ephesus. Paul referred to a lot of those difficulties and that spiritual battle as the beast of Ephesus. But as difficult as it had been to get this church started, to have it there, the church remained. Timothy was the pastor, probably facing some of those same beasts that Paul had faced. And Paul is concerned for Timothy. He's concerned about Timothy's spiritual stamina. He's concerned about his perseverance. He's concerned about his faith. He's concerned that Timothy is being persuaded by a lot of false teachers who are going around undermining the true gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as Paul's ministry. And certainly Paul is concerned about the church. He's concerned about the work of the kingdom of God that's been established in Ephesus. And all these things were weighing heavily on Paul's heart and spirit. So he writes this letter to Timothy with the purpose of motivating and stirring Timothy up in his faith. Now, last week, we spend some time in verses 13 and 14, chapter 1, where Paul strongly exhorted Timothy to hold fast to the pattern of sound words. And he's telling Timothy to stand firm in the solid truths of the Old Testament, those holy scriptures that Timothy had been taught as a child, also that words that Paul had spoken to Timothy, teachings from other disciples, hold fast to these sound words. And some of these teachings and these doctrines would have been letters written to the Christians around the area, and eventually they have come part to be of the New Testament that we know today. Some of these sound words probably just came from Paul and Timothy spending time together as they ministered together. Bottom line, Timothy had been taught good, solid truths of the kingdom of God, and Paul did not want Timothy to lose that. He also told him there to keep that good thing which has been committed to you. This wonderful treasure that's been placed in your heart, that moment when Jesus shone his light in your heart and he saved you and he brought you to a place of peace and joy, that's a treasure. And Paul is exhorting him to guard that good treasure. And he told him it's by the keeping power of the Holy Spirit that that good thing can be protected. And that is a repeat of what we saw Paul had written here in verse 8, where he said, according to the power of God, according to the power of God, that God would help Timothy to be able to share in the sufferings of the gospel of Jesus. So now he's talking about the Holy Spirit, the power of God would be the one to help Timothy to guard and to keep that good thing. And we talked a little bit about the two parts of keeping that good thing. We have a part, we have the opportunity, a part to participate in keeping that good thing. As we stay in fellowship with Christ every day, as we pray, we meditate on his word, we spend time in his word studying, we gather together with other brothers and sisters, we listen to the Holy Spirit as he guides us and he helps us with personal convictions and boundaries and growing and producing fruit. These are ways that we have opportunity to nurture that good thing that's been put in us. And then there's the power of God, his mercy, his grace, his faithfulness. As we do our part, he's faithful to help us. And even on those days when we're not so faithful, aren't you grateful? He always remains faithful. It's just this blessed partnership that we have and this connection. But ultimately, it's the power of the Holy Spirit. He's the one with the power and the strength. I'm so grateful for the keeping power of the Holy Spirit. He does what we cannot do. And aren't you grateful for that? Well, today we're going to look at the next few verses, and we're going to actually finish out chapter 1. And we're going to see Paul come in from another direction. He's so creative how the Spirit helps him. He's coming in from another direction now to stir up Timothy. So let's start reading in verse 15. This you know, that all those in Asia have turned away from me, among whom are Phygellus and Hermogenes. The Lord grant mercy to the household of Onesiphorus, for he often refreshed me and was not ashamed of my chain. But when he arrived in Rome, he sought me out very zealously and found me. The Lord grant to him that he may find mercy from the Lord in that day. And you know very well how many ways he ministered to me at Ephesus. Now, in this passage, Paul addresses some people by name. Some were his friends, and others were not his friends. And he still calls them out by name. And he begins with the ones who are no longer his friends, Phygellus and Hermogenes. Now, the way that this is written, it's understood that Timothy would have known who these people were. Remember, Timothy and Paul had been together for many years in ministry, so no doubt he was acquainted with these people. Now, Paul doesn't elaborate on these two men other than they were from Asia and that they had turned away from Paul. We don't know the particulars in this break in the friendship, but it was probably related that Paul was a prisoner now. And Paul mentions here that there were others in Asia who turned against him, but he only calls out these specific two by name. And it's thought that by specifically naming them, that the behavior of these two men, whatever it was worthy of being named, or at least noting, that it had a component to it, their behavior, that could have been dangerous to Timothy or dangerous to the work in Ephesus. And it's thought that because these are the only ones he named from Asia, that they may have been well known in the area. And again, we don't know what happened, but it's very probable that when Paul was arrested and placed in prison, they turned away from him. Now, this had to be very hurtful for Paul. You know, it's one thing to have people outside the faith to walk away from you, people who are not saved, they're not of the same Christian mindset. It still hurts. You miss them. It's sad. But it's more understandable. But when it's people that you have shared a common faith with, maybe people you've worked with in ministry, people that you have fellowshipped with, you've sat around a table for hours. We call them at our house a Hollywood lunch. You've had Hollywood lunches with these people, and you've shared Jesus stories with them. And then to have them walk away from you, shun you, it's painful. There is nothing quite like that kind of break in a friendship. King David had one of these breaks in a friendship, and he writes about it in Psalms 55. Let me read some of this and just see if David's words don't express that pain so well. He starts in verse 4, "My heart is severely pained within me, and the terrors of death have fallen upon me. Fearfulness and trembling have come upon me, and horror has overwhelmed me. So I said, oh, that I had wings like a dove. I would fly away and be at rest. Indeed, I would wander far off and remain in the wilderness. I would hasten my escape from the windy storm and tempest." And then he goes on to in verse 12, "For it is not an enemy who reproaches me, then I could bear it. Nor is it one who hates me who has exalted himself against me, then I could hide from him. But it was you, a man my equal, my companion and my acquaintance. We took sweet counsel together and walked to the house of God in the throng." Doesn't he do a great job articulating the pain and the hurt of someone that you once fellowshipped with within the body of Christ, and now you're no longer friends? It's just simply not fun. Now, gratefully, David finishes this psalm with verse 22, "Cast your burden on the Lord, and he shall sustain you." Encouraging words to help us in that pain. But it is painful. And no doubt for Paul, this was even more painful because these men had worked with him, and they knew Paul. They knew his character. They knew his integrity. They had known his walk with the Lord. And just because he was in prison, he had not changed being the same godly man he had always been. And if their walking away had to do with his being arrested, possibly they were afraid for their own lives of having any association with him. As we've talked before, this was a very dark time of great persecution for the church. And these men may have only been thinking about themselves and their own safety. It still was selfish on their part, and even more so because Paul had probably not just ministered with them in various places, but he had also ministered to them. You know, he had poured into their lives just as he was pouring into Timothy. And now for them to walk away, and maybe even more that Paul doesn't tell us here. So we have to ask the question, why is Paul telling Timothy this? You know, was he complaining? Was he trying to get some kind of sympathy from Timothy? That doesn't seem like that would work with Paul, that he doesn't fit his character. Or was he just kind of sharing a bit of news, you know, about what's happening? I don't think this letter is a newsy kind of letter. Paul has a purpose. Paul has a purpose in sharing this and to specifically name these men. And I think that Paul's purpose here is twofold. So I want us to look at these two possibilities. We'll start with the first one. Paul is telling Timothy about these two men rejecting him so that Timothy could be aware of the change in the hearts of these men toward Paul, and not just toward Paul, but possibly toward any works or ministries that Paul would have established, such as Ephesus. Again, almost there's this dangerous or sinister motive against Paul as he names this, and against his ministry as they turned away from him. And Paul was concerned. If they have turned away from me, Timothy, it's very possible they're going to turn away from you. After all, Paul and Timothy were close, and these men would have known that. So Paul is actually looking out for Timothy. He's looking out for the work of Ephesus. He's looking to protect a church that he struggled against the beast of Ephesus to establish. Paul had put some blood, sweat, and tears in Ephesus. And he's concerned what kind of influence these men would have had over that work that God was doing there in Ephesus. And we know from Paul's character and his integrity, it's not a selfish interest or a self-glory for the church in Ephesus. You know, I established it and, you know, this is my legacy. We got to protect my legacy. That's not where Paul is coming from. It's rather that the kingdom of God would be hindered. The gospel of Jesus Christ would be hindered. It's got to continue here in Ephesus. So Paul is concerned that these men could cause harm to Timothy's ministry, to this work here in Ephesus. Now, this would have been the same reason that Paul shared about Alexander the coppersmith over in chapter 4, verse 14. Alexander the coppersmith did me much harm. And Paul there gives a description of Alexander in case if there was more than one Alexander. I want you to know which Alexander I'm talking about. It's the coppersmith Alexander. Paul is wanting Timothy to be aware and to be on high alert. Timothy, there are people out there who are willing and able to hurt your ministry and to sabotage the work that God is doing through you. Not everybody has your best interest at heart. Paul knew that Timothy was a sensitive guy. He might have been a bit gullible. He's got this caring nature. He's believing and trusting of everyone. And Paul has to tell him with the discernment of the Holy Spirit, there are those claiming to still be in the body of Christ, but they want to hurt your ministry and ultimately hurt the work of Jesus Christ. So it's out of concern for Timothy. It's out of concern for the work at Ephesus that he's naming names. And there's a great truth here in this scripture for us. Sometimes it's okay to name names. Sometimes it's okay to call out behavior, to communicate possible danger when it comes to causing destruction to the kingdom of God, to the work in a church or in a ministry. There's a bigger picture here. It's not personal. We're talking the kingdom of God. We're talking business in the church. We're talking the work and the gospel of Jesus Christ. If someone has a history or they have a strong potential of causing spiritual harm against the woman or man of God, it's okay to speak out and to share that with the minister. Sister, I think you need to be careful with this lady. I think you need to be careful with this situation. Paul was not breaking any confidentiality rules by alerting Timothy of these men and what they had done by walking away from relationship with him. These men had shown selfish behavior. They had shown they were only concerned with themselves and not the true message that Paul, an established man of God, was preaching. They weren't trustworthy. They weren't dependable. And Paul did not want Timothy to be blindsided by these men if they happened to come into the church at Ephesus or they wanted to start helping Timothy. Timothy had to know. And Paul cared enough about Timothy to tell him. Over in 1 Thessalonians 5:12, Paul had exhorted the leaders there to know those who labor among you. It's the responsibility of the pastor and the leadership to know who's laboring among them. And Paul's withholding the information could have been very dangerous for Timothy. It could have been very dangerous for the work at Ephesus. It's okay to share with leadership when someone has the potential of causing harm to the work of Jesus Christ. Certainly if you know something that that leadership may not be aware of. Because sheep talk to sheep, you know? At the feeding trough, at the water bowl. And there may be something that you know that even the leadership doesn't know. And suddenly your red flags, discernment, something's wrong. It's okay. It's okay to share with leadership. Because Timothy might have been totally clueless about these two guys. But Paul cared enough about Timothy and the church to alert him. And just think of how Timothy would have felt, the hurt and the confusion he would have experienced if he would have found out later that Paul had known all along these guys were bad company, but he never said anything to Timothy. And if they had come in and caused a lot of chaos for the church, how would Timothy have felt? Paul, I thought you were my friend. Paul, I thought you were loyal to me. There is a responsibility that Paul feels he has toward Timothy, that he has toward the work that's going on in Ephesus. He has to share it. He is compelled by God, by the Holy Spirit here, to alert Timothy, who's the pastor at Ephesus. Now, absolutely, there's a right way to share it, just like Paul does here. He shares it directly to Timothy. You go and you speak directly to the leadership. You don't go to everyone else in the church. You go directly to the pastor, to the leader, and you just share what you know or what you've seen. And then you pray. God, give the pastor, give the leadership wisdom what to do. And you know, it's very possible that your information may simply confirm what the Holy Spirit has laid on that leadership, what the leadership may have already been sensing about that person or that situation. And you walk in and share this bit of news, and suddenly confirmation, all the pieces go together. Look how God had used you. But when you withhold that information, it can then be very dangerous for the kingdom of God and for the work God wants to do, especially if you know information that involves sin, it involves rebellion, or it could cause discord in the body of Christ. And we know from Proverbs chapter 6, God hates one who sows discord among the brethren. So it's okay to call out certain behaviors, to share with leadership when those behaviors could damage a ministry, damage a minister, or sabotage in some way the work that God wants to do in a place. And if we withhold that information, we actually become a tool in Satan's plan to cause destruction to the work of Christ. We don't ever want to be a tool in Satan's plan. Paul is boldly speaking to Timothy about these two men. He calls out Alexander the coppersmith. Over in chapter 4, verse 10, he calls out Demas, who, having forsaken Paul and loving now this present world. In his great concern for Timothy, the ministry at Ephesus, Paul tells Timothy about these men. It's a very loving thing for Paul to do. Powerful example for us. Now, the other part of what Paul is doing here in these verses is showing Timothy two groups of people: bad company and good company. The Phygellus and Hermogenes, who've walked away from Paul, and then Onesiphorus, who's still supporting Paul. And Paul gives great detail of how Onesiphorus is supporting him. So it's very easy to see the contrast between these two groups of people. We can see two different responses to Paul's imprisonment for the cause of Christ. And we can't forget, Paul is in prison, in chains, because he has continued to preach the truth of Jesus. He's not there because of something evil he's done. He's there because he's been faithful to the call of God on his life. He's been faithful as an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. And by writing about these two groups, calling them out by name, we can see the two differences, the different responses to Paul being in prison. Bad company and good company. And Timothy can look at these and make a choice. He can see, am I going to choose to support the furtherance of the gospel of Christ, or am I going to support those who walk away from supporting Paul and what Paul has done? He could choose. So let's look at this man, Onesiphorus, and see what he can teach us. The name Onesiphorus means useful. What a sweet name, useful. Or great prophet, as in P-R-O-F-I-T, useful. It's a great prophet to me to have you as my friend or to have you working here. Useful. And this sets him apart already from these other men that Paul had named. Phygellus and Hermogenes are no longer useful to the ministry. And you know, it's interesting, this word useful is the description that Paul later gives about John Mark over in chapter 4, verse 11. Paul instructs Timothy to bring Mark to him, for he is useful to me in ministry. Now remember, this is the Mark who had abandoned Paul and Barnabas in their first missionary journey in Acts 13. So somewhere through the years, Mark had gotten it all together, and now he's useful to Paul. You know, isn't that exciting? There was hope for Mark. There's hope for all of us. We can get it together, and we can now be useful. Onesiphorus was useful. He was of a great profit to Paul. Phygellus, one of the bad company, his name actually meant fugitive, which described what he did to Paul. He ran away from him. So Paul writes here that Onesiphorus often refreshed him. Often. This is in verse 16. He was frequent in caring for Paul. It wasn't just a one-time deal. He was there often, refreshing him. And Paul writes about when Onesiphorus was in Rome, he very zealously, with great diligence, went looking for Paul. He went there to find him, even though he knew Paul was in prison. He went there looking for him. Now, we have to remember, prisons during this time in Rome, nothing like the prisons we have today. In fact, to be held in a Roman prison was just simply a waiting place until you were brought to trial. You were never given a prison sentence as part of your punishment. You were either released at your trial, you're not guilty, you can go, or you were killed. You're guilty, it's done, it's over with. You weren't sent to prison as a punishment. You're here in this waiting place. Paul is waiting for his trial, chained as a common criminal. We see that in chapter 2, verse 9. He writes of he was suffering as an evildoer, even to the point of chains. What was Paul's crime? He had been an apostle of Jesus Christ, preaching the gospel. And Paul knew in his spirit that he was not to be released. We see that in chapter 4, verse 6. The time of my departure is at hand. And often the waiting time at these Roman prisons was not very long. Trials and certainly the executions came quickly. So for Onesiphorus to find Paul and to find him in the correct prison, there were several in Rome and they didn't have the best record keeping, so to identify where he was in a short amount of time to get to him, all this was very admirable on the part of this man. Now some scholars believe that Paul was in Mamertine prison, which was known to have a dungeon called Tullianum. And in this dungeon, just to give an idea of where Paul was staying. It had a stream of water running through it that actually served as the sewage outlet for the city. So not a nice place. Prisoners were only given a small portion of food each day. None of their personal care was attended, so anything extra that they needed, it had to come from the outside. So when Paul writes that Onesiphorus came to him often and refreshed him, we understand that as long as he was in Rome, Onesiphorus was there at the prison, giving food, giving clothing, giving any type of personal care that Paul may have needed. How refreshing that would have been for Paul in these circumstances. He might not have been able to see his friend. Now, before, when Paul had been arrested earlier in Acts 24, he was more of a house arrest, and he got to see his friends. They could come and go, and he could teach them and fellowship and talk with them. Not this time. But still, Onesiphorus came. He might not have gotten to see him, but he was there. He was given these items. He was not ashamed of Paul's chains. How much that had meant to Paul. It refreshed him. And we have to think, you know, there was a lot of cruelty and corruptness existed in these places. And so it was never guaranteed that the prisoner would actually receive the items that their guest had brought into them. But somehow, according to this, Paul received it. Somehow, God in his mercy allowed Paul to receive this care, even in a dark dungeon with the sewage running through it. What a merciful Jesus. Onesiphorus was not ashamed of Paul's chains. He didn't regret being Paul's friend. He knew Paul was the real deal. He knew he was a true apostle of Jesus Christ. He continued to support Paul, to stand by him, to pray for him, and to encourage him in whatever way he could. What a contrast to the other men Paul wrote about. And what's interesting is that this was not a new behavior for Onesiphorus. If you look at the end of verse 18, Paul tells Timothy, "You know very well how many ways he ministered to me at Ephesus." When Paul was at Ephesus, working there with Timothy at the church, trying to get it established, fighting the beast of Ephesus, Onesiphorus was there ministering to him in many ways. So he's just being consistent with what he has always done in his relationship with Paul. Aren't you grateful for friends that are that just simply stay the same, who are consistent? You know, regardless of what's happening in your life, whether it's good or whether it's bad, they continue to be your friend. They celebrate you. They support you. They stay with you. Onesiphorus was Paul's friend. He was Paul's friend all the time. When Paul was out and about free doing this great work in Ephesus, and then now when he's in prison, simply being his friend, encouraging him and refreshing him. He's a constant. What an example for us. That's good company, company we want to hang out with. And Paul writes here, in verse 18, that there were many ways that Onesiphorus had ministered to Paul. Maybe it was with food. Maybe with a word of encouragement, just by going to his house, praying for him. Maybe he blessed him with an offering. We used to call those Pentecostal handshake, where you had some money in your hand, and when you shook hands with someone, you left it. That was a Pentecostal handshake. We know that during the time Paul was in Ephesus, he taught disciples at a school. We see that in Acts 19. So maybe Onesiphorus helped with the administrative part of keeping up with the students, you know, just little things. But yet to Paul, it was a great blessing, a way to minister to him. And Paul was very grateful for this wonderful man of God. And he prays for his friend here in verse 18. The Lord grant to him that he may find mercy from the Lord in that day. And the expression "in that day" was referring to the time when Onesiphorus would stand before Jesus and give an account of what he had done for him. And Paul is praying, Lord, grant him mercy on that day because of all that he's done. Paul is praying that Jesus would look kindly on him because he's been a blessing. And I want to just encourage you today that no matter what you do for the kingdom of God, it does not go unnoticed by Jesus. It does not go unnoticed. Jesus said in Mark chapter 9, verse 41, "For whoever gives you a cup of water to drink, just a cup of water, in my name, because you belong to Christ, assuredly I say to you, he will by no means lose his reward." Just a cup of water. Doesn't seem like a big deal. But Jesus is talking here. Jesus would see it. The kingdom of heaven would see it. And you would not lose your reward for that. Colossians chapter 3, verse 23. "And whatever you do, cup of water, go into the prison, giving clothes, pray, whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance, for you serve the Lord Christ." No matter what it is, how small, how insignificant that it may seem, if you're doing it for the cause of Christ, in his name, for his glory, you will receive inheritance, for you serve the Lord Christ. And it's key that we notice, "for you serve the Lord Christ." If we're doing our good deeds just to be seen of men, Jesus talked about that with the Pharisees. If we're doing our good deeds just to be seen, we have to tell everyone what we've done. We post it. If we do it for some selfish ambition or to meet a personal need of, "it makes me feel so good." Well, yes, it probably does, but that sounds nice, but you look at that, that's still satisfying self. It makes me feel good? Who's it all about? Our good works must be done unto the Lord. Unto the Lord. I'm going to tell you a story, and I hope you follow this. We had a certain group. There was a group of friends in our previous church. They were a group of friends, a unique group of friends. And one Sunday morning, the leader of the group, a unique lady, came to me and she told me that the whole group would not be in service that night. We had Sunday night service because they were all going to go out of town to visit a lady from the church who was in the hospital. Now, the hospital was about an hour's drive away, so it was going to take some time to make the visit. They had to go all afternoon, all evening, to go visit this lady, this whole group. Now, it was a bit puzzling to us when I told my husband about it at lunch that day, because this particular group of people, I had never seen them interacting with the lady who was in the hospital. They sat on opposite sides, and there everyone had assigned seats. Well, they weren't assigned, but you always sat in the same seat. In fact, when we went there, they gave me a chart so that I could learn who was who because of everyone sat in the same seat. So they didn't even sit on the same sides of the church, and I never saw them interact with each other. So I'm a little puzzled. Why are you going to drive that far to go see her when you don't normally talk to her? And why do you need to go on Sunday evening and skip church? And why does everybody have to go? The husbands and the wives. It's a lady in the hospital. Why does the husband need to go? All three of them. Anyway, we were a little confused. So later, you know, we had church, had a great time. Sometime later, this same leader of the group, she comes to me to report. Had to report. You got to report when you've done a good deed. She came to report to me about the good deed. "Oh, we had a great time visiting at the hospital. But oh, sister, we had a wonderful time when we went out to eat afterwards." Now, on the surface, sounded nice, but come on, who are we kidding? What was the real motive of that hospital visit an hour away on Sunday night with all my friends? Gratefully, Pastor and I did not have to sort out all the answers of why people do what they do. Jesus knows that, and he knows the truth. But I encourage you this morning, I encourage myself, let everything we do be as unto the Lord. Unto the Lord. And when we're doing it to please Jesus, that keeps us in full obedience to him. And it answers the question, is this something Jesus really wants me to do? So now this opens up another direction. And I've made reference to this before, but it's a truth, especially here in this area. We all need to be reminded of from time to time. The virtuous woman in Proverbs 31 verse 16 says, she considers a field and then she buys it. Some other versions say she ponders the field and she buys it. This virtuous woman who we all want to imitate, she does not go out and buy the field without considering it, without thinking about it. She pondered her action before she did it. And there's a truth there for us. Is this good deed something that God wants for me to do? Does God want me to miss church on Sunday night to travel an hour to go visit some lady I never speak to so I can hang out with my friends afterwards? Is this a good deed that God wants me to do? Not every crisis has my name on it. I'm not called to meet every need, even if it's a ministry need. Now hear me out, okay? Often we get so busy with responding to every 911 that people tell us about, we're going here and there, out and about, trying to solve every crisis, fill in every gap, and we've never stopped to consider, we've never stopped to ponder, is this something God is calling me to do? Especially if we're caring people by nature, if we are fix-it people by nature, and most women are. The very thing that is our strength can become our weakness. We can get so busy fixing everybody else's crisis until our husbands, our children, our homes, our personal devotions, even our health completely neglected. And then we wonder why the kids are misbehaving. Then we wonder why our husband, something's off with him. How many times have you been home that week? How much energy are you exerting on everybody else's 911, but you haven't been at home to be with your family? You haven't spent time with the Lord. Stop. Consider the field. Ponder. Is this something God wants me to do? Pray about it. Pray about it. And I just want to encourage you, those who are married, if your husband has told you, no, I don't think you should do this, please listen. Please listen. He's the priest of the home. Please listen. When we're walking in obedience to Jesus' call, okay, Lord, you said I could do this. This is good. I can do this. Then we can step out boldly. We can go buy that field. We can do whatever it is. No matter how big or small it is, we can do it in his name, give him glory. We know he's watching, he's seeing, and he's going to reward us one day. And there's peace at the house. I hope this is helpful to somebody. Consider the field. Ponder the good deed. Ask the Lord before you volunteer. You're always going to have people ask you to volunteer, especially if you're a good, hard worker. Okay, it's going to happen. You don't have to say yes. A great answer is, let me get back with you. Let me pray about it. Let me check my schedule. And then take time and truly pray about it. What does God want me to do? Consider the field. Paul lays out before Timothy two kinds of people, two kinds of responses to his being in prison. And Timothy had a choice. We have a choice. Will we stand beside those who preach the truth? Will we support them? Will we do all that God is calling us to do to refresh and encourage them? Will we guard the truth of Jesus and guard the work God's wanting us to do? Or will we walk away? Will we do harm? Will we cause discord, be a part of chaos, and ultimately hinder the kingdom of God going forward? Bad company, good company. So I leave you with this advice. Choose to be an Onesiphorus. It's not a disease, that's his name. He was useful. Choose to be part of good company. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for your word today. I thank you, Father, for these names and nuggets and truths that are hidden in your word, that we can grow and learn and become better, stronger, more powerful women of God for you. And we can go forward boldly in our faith, walking in obedience to what you've called us to do. Oh, let the Holy Spirit take these words today and just resonate in our spirit and our heart, Lord. God, let it divide asunder and set apart truth from lie and deceit, oh God, from truth. And Lord, our own opinions from your truth and our own expectations or what we've always envisioned from your truth, Lord. Let us walk in your truth. In Jesus' name, touch us by your power, Lord. So we go forward in Jesus' name, according to the power of God. We thank you and praise you, Lord. Amen.